Good day to you all. Bill Pfeiffer speaking from Mary's Field. Again, press the like button if you'd like, and share with your friends. It's a way to help them grow as well. Yesterday we talked a little bit and beautifully about the vision of Anne Catherine Emmerich and her vision and the way she saw the birth of Jesus. And I don't know, just try to tell me that isn't true. It just is. But the books that I was referring to were the Dolorous Passion of Our Lord Jesus Christ and The Life of Mary as Seen by Mystics, mostly by Anne Catherine Emmerich. Two jewels. They just feed your heart. They take the beautiful gospel message of Luke, for example, the birth of Jesus, and flesh it out with a little more of the detail, which helps us to be a little more comfortable and to be able to kind of give our hearts to the birth of Jesus in a deeper way. Today I have a beautiful little allegory for you. It's just a beautiful story. I used to love reading it to my students. Just listen with your heart. Let it happen, and it will touch you, and you'll be able to enter into, I think, a deeper relationship with yourself and with others and with prayer. Once there was a tree in the forest. He was a very silent tree. The other trees whistled in the wind, whispered their secrets one to another, rustled their leaves in the new excitement of each day. But not this tree. He remained silent from the day he first pushed his little head above the ground. His parents waited with eagerness for his first sound, but it never came. As the other trees chattered away, he alone remained silent. "Why are you so quiet?" he was asked again and again. In response, he merely wept silently. He didn't know why. He tried again and again to whistle, to whisper, to rustle with the wind, but nothing happened. Sometimes his heart would be so full of what he wanted to share with the others, but when he tried, nothing came forth. He was just a silent tree, no matter how hard he tried. As he grew older, he became familiar with death. A few of the trees lived to a ripe old age, and their life energy spent peacefully died, but not many. Most were taken young, cut down in the prime of their life, and used to serve man's needs. As tree matured, he began to worry about this. He saw one after another of his peers go, and he was afraid, for he longed to, most of all in his life, he longed to be able to speak, to pour out his heart to his fellow trees. Secretly, he hoped beyond all hope that someday, somehow, this would happen. And he didn't want to die before it did. He didn't want to die before he had really lived, before he had found his voice. Yet day after day, silence remained his companion. Then one day the woodcutters appeared in the forest again. He saw others of his neighbors felled. The one woodcutter approached him. He knew it was the end. He wept bitterly, disappointed. His dream would never be realized. He submitted to the axe and was dragged out of the forest. The next few days were very confusing. There was pain, lots of pain. He lost all of his lovely leaves, and his once graceful form was utterly destroyed as he was cut this way and that. Then came the time when he was set aside in pieces for what seemed a long, long time. Finally, one day, a young man picked him up gently and started working with him. Tree quivered with great anticipation as he was bent and cut and shaped and glued. Sometimes it hurt, yet he sensed something good in the air and let the man do as he will with him. And little by little, he saw himself take another shape, not like the one he had as a tree, but a beautiful one nonetheless. He had never seen anything quite like it. What did man call it? Yes, a violin, that was it. The young man picked him up and started to play. And poor tree wept with joy. He was hearing his own voice for the first time, the voice he had given up on ever hearing. He was speaking. He was singing. Yes, he was pouring out his heart in song. The young man walked with him back into the forest. And he sang to all of the trees there. He sang and he sang. Once alive in that same forest, he had been silent. But now that he was transformed, he sang songs of great joy. And one of the trees bent down and kissed him. The name of this is simply Fable by Jude Fletcher. Beautiful, beautiful story. And it's a story of transformation and change, isn't it? It's the story of our lives. It's the way that things have to be. You know, Jesus is often roundly rejected as a serious model because a few people want to believe in the pattern that that his life is, it gives. You know, the divine pattern revealed is in the Trinity and Jesus is loss and renewal, you know, self-emptying and the living of a richer, expanded life, surrender and receiving, you know, death and resurrection, darkness and light. You know, there are always these opposites that seem to produce nothing but going down. And so we do read roundly, we reject Jesus and his message as any kind of serious model. A few people, you know, really believe in this pattern, and yet it is the big and the redemptive pattern of all of life is dying and rising, isn't it? We do this all the time, huh? You know, it's really, really something. By and large, most human beings want resurrection without death. They want light without darkness. They want a conclusion without the process. Maybe what we can say is that we don't like Jesus when we don't like reality, because reality is this. It's dying. It's going down that we might go up. That's the real world, you know. And what happens is mechanical thinking takes over in our lives, and our lives run on autopilot, says Richard Rohr, you know, a spin cycle of passing pleasure and purposeless pain. Transformation, that's what happened to little tree here in our beautiful fable, and it's what needs to happen in our own lives if we're going to produce life. It's dying is rising, you know, unless the grain of seed falls into the ground and dies, it remains just a grain of seed. But if it dies, it produces great life. When I am weak, then I am strong. In weakness, power reaches perfection. Unless you become like little children, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. We don't like that message, though, do we? In the West, we have, you know, all of this performance kind of Christianity. You know, it's doing things that really matters. In the East, it's about becoming divine, and that's much more real, much more true. The reason why we exist as a people, to find that true self, to be transformed, to become into the mind and heart of Jesus. So little by little, remember the story and know that transform people. That's the way it works. And transformation takes an awful lot of dying and rising, giving up, surrendering, emptying so that we might be filled. That is the true message. You know, going down is somehow going up. You know, it's the name of Rohr's book, Falling Upwards. And that's the way that life really is to be lived. So remember that always, you know, doing the truth today is really essential in order to be able to live with the real right things tomorrow. You have to do the right things today. Happiness tomorrow always depends on doing the truth today. Good to be with you again. We're going to try to share some things that have nice stories and so on from here to Christmas. So stay tuned with us. The podcast will be something that will touch and I think touch your heart and help you to prepare for the great feast of Christmas. God bless. Be with you again tomorrow.